Hey guys, Sam here. Welcome back to our channel. So over the course of the spring of 2024, Angela and I undertook a large project of installing an off-grid system and connecting it to our home. That consisted of building two giant solar arrays that were ground mount systems that handled about 14,000 watts of solar. Also installing our Lux Power inverter, our BigBattery ETHOS battery system, and then connecting it to our home through a Reliance ProTran 2 transfer switch box. Here we are now, late summer 2024, and in today's video, we are going to be installing a battery expansion to our ETHOS battery system to double the capacity. We worked with a different company for the actual inverter and battery install, but this video is sponsored by Signature Solar, who also sells the BigBattery ETHOS battery expansions, and we are working with them on this partnership. So a big thanks for Signature Solar for reaching out to us and helping us out to expand our battery pack. Once you have the base plate on the floor, make sure you have it oriented correctly. The thicker portion goes towards the back, and then sit your first battery on top of your base plate. At that point, my recommendation is to go ahead and get out your wall brackets, start your screws on the bottom of the bracket, and at least hold that battery first to the wall. Then get your second battery, stack it, and attach the bracket. It's a lot easier to reach the stuff one step at a time, and like I said, it's my recommendation at least. So you're looking at the left side of the battery, and this screw right here, it's at the top, is the one you want to take out and that you will use to attach your bracket to. Depending upon how far off it is from the wall, find the slot that it fits into and then loosely thread it into place. Make sure you don't have it so tight that you can't adjust this bracket. At this point, grab a level, make sure this is plumb to your wall, back or forth, wherever you want it, and go ahead and lock down your bracket against the wall. I'm using a socket adapter, and this is an 8mm socket to work with these screws that attach the bracket to the wall. Now I'm just going to leave this loose for now, because I want to wait till I have the other battery here to make sure its screw lines up here to connect, and then I'll adjust the bracket there. But at least at this point, this battery is not going to fall over as we stack them up. So this is the left side. I'm going to repeat the process over here to the right side, and then we'll bring the battery over and we'll stack it on top of this one. Oh yeah. Don't forget to take your screws out of your next battery, otherwise it won't go on the brackets. Since this is the last of our stack, all we need to do is take the screw out of the top of the battery and then attach the bracket, and we're done. About 30 minutes later, and the hardest part of this project is done. The batteries themselves are heavy, but they are now mounted and secured to the wall. Awesome. The next thing to do, according to the user manual, which I have a printed version here, but it's also available online, is to set the battery's ID. So my first stack, this one, we have three batteries, and those dip switches on the left were set to 1, 2, 3. What I'm going to do is continue that operation, or nomenclature rather, and do 4, 5, 6 on these additional batteries. There is a graphic in the book, or also printed online, where you can see what the ID combination is to equal your numbers, so just flip them however you want. After that's done, we'll put the plates back over, and then we'll start to wire these together. Right here on the left side, where it says ID, this is the plate with the two screws you want to remove. Inside here, this little blue box, these are the switches that you want to flip up or down as directed by the manual to give each battery a unique identification number. All right, on the bottom battery, we're going to take off this top cap where it says COM1. And at this point is where you put our wire and plug it into it. You push it in and then you thread it into place. It's a nice watertight coupler. Since this battery system is weather rated as well, everything is good and watertight. So with the bottom one done, we now fish the wire up and we connect it into the bottom port of the next battery up in the stack. So removing the cap on what says COM2, we bring the wire up from below, make sure it's oriented correctly, push it into place, and then tighten down the screw cap. And that is it. You just repeat the process as you go up your stack, and when you reach the top of the battery, you're gonna do what you're about to see next. You get a long cable in this kit, and it's to connect the bottom battery COM2 port over to the bottom battery COM2 port on your first stack. There's a diagram in the instructions. I'll show you guys a picture of it, but that's what I'm doing next. I'm gonna run the wire behind the battery stack, so it's less likely to get snagged by anything in here. All right, with the wire fished over, you then take it and plug it in right there and then stick the rest of it behind your battery stack. With the communication wires now connected and the battery dip switches done, the next thing to do is connect the batteries together using the included cables and make sure you follow the diagram in your manual. So the graphic you're seeing is how it needs to be connected. That's going to vary based upon the number of batteries you're connecting, so make sure you consult your manual. Also, in case it's not clear, make sure all power is turned off, all the battery breakers. If you have your inverter wired in from grid, every single bit of power off. I didn't say that earlier, but it's very important. You don't want to die just yet, so all the power needs to be off. All right, here's a look at the cables. They come with a kit, and again, follow your instructions. Feed them behind the white handle here because you need that for your covers to still fit. So you just kind of push it here, and then I like to just hit it right in place. They click and they fit wonderfully. With the short wires connected, now we're going to take our long wires and connect it up just like the diagram shows us. We just ran our long set of cables from the bottom battery in stack 1 to the bottom battery in stack 2. Now we're going to take the other set of long cables and connect the top of stack 1 to the ETHOS control box. What we are basically doing is creating one giant loop from ETHOS box down stack 1, over to stack 2, up stack 2, and then over to the ETHOS. One big loop. Again, follow the instructions, it'll make it really easy for you. At this point, we are done. Our installation and our expansion of our battery bank is complete. So I'm going to replace the covers for our dip switches, turn on each individual battery's breaker, then their power button, both on this stack and the other. Once all the batteries are on, then I will turn on the ETHOS control box and we'll check everything. Hopefully it shows us additional capacities, that it's got communication to everything. Once that checks out, then we'll flip the switches over on our inverter, connecting the batteries to the inverter and re-energizing our system. What's great about these batteries is they have an all-weather cover on the breaker. Again, because they're rated indoor-outdoor, but they're great for opening up, flipping the breaker, and then closing everything back up nice and tight. So you might be able to see from the display screen, but the ETHOS is now showing that we have 600 amp hours of battery, which is correct. 100 amp hour per battery, 6 batteries total. Next thing to do, is flip the switch on the Lux Power and start charging this stuff. And when it's full, we'll get to use it again. But I want to make sure I charge the entire battery stack to 100% before we start draining it. Well, as you guys are seeing on the screen with the Lux Power Inverter, I flipped the switch. We're now bringing solar into the system and it is charging our batteries. And given right now it's 7 p.m. in the afternoon, July, so a little bit of reference there on daylight, we're still bringing in about 1,300 watts of power, which is good. So let this guy charge up overnight and we'll see you guys in the next step, which is, I guess, talking about usability and actual real life lifespan of our whole system. So here we are a couple of months after the battery install, and I am very happy to say that once again with this whole system, it has been not on our mind because it has just plain worked. But now since we have the double battery capacity with that additional stack, it is really not on our mind. We have had zero power outages, zero problems with our entire home running off of the battery system. Okay, entire home minus water heater and kitchen stove. We have also changed our washer and dryer out for a heat pump unit. We didn't do that to just try and get off grid more. Our dryer died, our washer also died, like within a week of each other. And we decided, okay, let's get something else. And hey, let's get one that we can run completely off grid because it has a heat pump and runs off of 120 volt electricity. So awesome win. So along with that, our home, I guess you could say, is 98% off-grid. Honestly, the times that we use our large kitchen stove for cooking is very, very minimal. We'll use the cooktop probably more than anything, but we also have a toaster oven in our home, and we use that for, honestly, 95% of our cooking. It's just one of those things that is convenient, really, really convenient. Our water heater is still on grid, and I don't think that we'll be able to add it to our off-grid system. Not that the Lux Power could not handle it or the batteries could not power it. I just worry about the longevity of the battery system, and I think it will probably just tax it too much. We have an electric tank style water heater, and maybe if that one kicks the bucket, hopefully not anytime soon, maybe at that point we'll look at getting a propane tankless water heater, which is what I would really like. And at that point, then okay, we're that much more off-grid. But for now, paying for our water heat usage and our kitchen stove usage is not too bad. Outside of the home, we do have our workshops still on grid, but that is only the case as of right now. We're going to be working with Signature Solar in future videos about taking those structures off grid as much as possible as well. So if you're interested in that, definitely stick around. If you got questions or comments about the ETHOS battery expansion, definitely leave us a comment down below. Honestly, it is a piece of cake to do. It looks really nice and clean, and even though we have it in a storage building here for us, since we have a small single wide mobile home, if you had a larger home or just have the space inside your home, something like this is not too bad to look at. Appreciate you guys watching as always. Again, thanks to Signature Solar for sponsoring this one. There are links to the products down below. Otherwise, take care, and we'll see you guys next time on the channel.